students, so we are back again with the chapter food and health, the third part, that is with today's session we'll be concluding the chapter. So last class, as we have discussed about the process of digestion, I hope you remember. Now today we will be discussing, okay, before moving on to today's topic, let's just have a summary of the process of digestion. So I told you, digestion means what? It is the process by which the useful substances of food are broken down into simpler substances which can be taken by the body. So the digestion takes 6 to 8 hours. It takes 6 to 8 hours to complete the entire process of digestion. Now, as we have already discussed, like, the process of digestion starts with the mouth. As we chew the food gets mixed with the saliva, which is the digestive juice present in the mouth, and the food is changed into a paste. Then the food enters the food pipe. From the food pipe, the food enters the stomach. In the stomach, the food is continuously, it stays for a few hours and it is continuously churned, and certain acids gets mixed with the food in the stomachs, which kills the germs present in the food. From the stomach, the food enters the small intestine, which is a narrow tube. In the small intestine, the digestion of the carbohydrate, fats and proteins takes place, and also the digestive juice from the pancreas and the livers get mixed with the food. Next, the process here in the small intestine, the process of digestion is completed. Now, the undigested food, what happens to the undigested food? The undigested food passes on to the large intestine. Now, in the small intestine, with the end of the process of digestion, what happens? The useful substance of the food are absorbed by the blood vessels present in the small intestine, and then these useful nutrients are transported to every part of the body through the blood. Now, talking about the undigested food which has already entered the large intestine, what happens? The excess amount of water which is present in the food is absorbed by the walls of the large intestine, and it is again sent to the blood. And what remains after the water has been absorbed, the food particles, what remains is then thrown out of the body, or it comes out of the body through the anus as feces. Now next we will be talking about today proper cooking practices. So we have already discussed that different types of food contains different types of nutrients. So what were the nutrients? Carbohydrates, fats, vitamins, minerals, then proteins. So all this we get from different types of food. Now, if the food is not cooked properly, then these nutrients will be destroyed. That is, the proper amount of nutrients we will not get. Even if we eat that food, we will not get the proper amount of nutrients from the food. So again, some food we eat it raw, and some food needs to be cooked before eating. Now, improper method of cooking food destroys the nutrients of the food. Suppose, for example, the food containing vitamin C, like lemon, tomato, all this contains vitamin C. And if they are cooked, this food containing vitamin C, if they are cooked at a very high temperature, the nutrient content of the food, that is the vitamin C present in the food, is destroyed. Now, after, if we eat that food, the body will not get any amount of vitamin C from that particular food. So it is advisable to eat fruits or vegetables that contains vitamin C. It is advisable that you eat it raw without cooking it, in order to get the proper or the adequate see present in that particular food. Now again, rice, pulses, vegetables, what do? We at times boil it. So after boiling the vegetables in water, when we boil the vegetables or pulses or rice, you will see the boiled water contains a rich amount of nutrients. That is, the nutrients which is present in the food has been passed on to the boiled water. So if we the nutrients are lost if the water is thrown away. So it is better that we use that water for cooking. If we need to boil it, then instead of throwing away that water, use that water for cooking so that the nutrients remain intact with the food. Otherwise there will be no use of consuming that particular food item. Next, these two ways are there for cooking practice. Next we have, like, it is always advisable to take freshly cooked food, and the food should be prepared in a clean and safe place. So cooking again kills the germs which is present in the food and also makes the food safe for us to eat, as makes it safe for the body. Again, through cooking we are killing the germs. Now if that cooked food is left for a long period of time, again germs may come and grow there. So it is like, you should always try to have food or try to eat food which is freshly prepared, and you should avoid eating stale food. So what is stale food? Now if you keep the food for the cooked food for few hours, it becomes stale. Suppose tonight you will have the dinner, and that same cooked food you will keep it and you will have it tomorrow, then we will say that the food has become stale. So like, stale food is harmful for the body. Why? Because it may contain many harmful germs growing on it, and therefore it can also make us sick. So besides eating like those food items which are rich in vitamins should be eaten raw, then fruits and vegetables are vegetables, then pulses, rice, all this when we are boiling in water, that water should not be thrown away, because that water contains has a rich content of nutrients. Beside this, while cooking we should always maintain that the food is prepared in a clean atmosphere, and we should always try to eat freshly cooked food rather than stale food. So because stale food can make us sick. Why? Because germs, when the food is kept for the long period, germs develop in the food. Now certain food items needs to be preserved. Like you have seen the pickles, we keep it. Once your mother or grandmother makes the pickle, we store it for many days. So certain foods are preserved. Now there are like, again, when you bring some every day you cannot go to the market to bring the rice to get the pulses. So what do? Once we bring it in a certain quantity, then we store it. So this is called the process of preserving food. So sometimes the food, if it is not stored properly, that is, if it is not preserved properly, it can get spoiled. How? Like different kinds of, if the rice, pulses, all these are not preserved in an airtight container, different types of insects may develop, worms or insects may develop in them. Again, the food may be damaged. Again, in case of pickles, germs, you will say, see certain fungal growths have developed. So different kinds of food which needs to be preserved should be preserved in a proper way, in an airtight container. So I'll show you some of the pictures on different ways of preserving food. So here you can see four different ways are given for preserving food. This one, rice, pulses, how they have preserved. This is by proper storing. That is, they have stored it into, you should store it in a proper airtight container. Then canning and bottling. Again, so food items like jams, pickles, they are canned or bottled in order to preserve them. Again, one of the way of preserving food that we do in our normal day-to-day life is refrigeration. So whatever food remains, what do? We put it into the refrigerator so that we can have it later on. Next process is drying. You have seen like certain food items, they are dried mangoes, then coconuts, they are dried in the, when they are available in the particular season, that time they are dried so that they can be used overall throughout the year. So these are the process of preserving food. What are the process? Proper storage, canning and bottling, refrigeration and drying. So with this, we have come to an end of this chapter, food and health. So I'll be giving you some questions which you can try it by yourself. So the questions based on today's topic, you can see, mention any two proper cooking practices. Any two ways of proper cooking practices, then mention any two ways of preserving food. So I hope you will be able to answer these questions. If you go through the video, you will get the answers to this question. So with this, we have concluded the chapter food and health. So next class we will be taking another chapter. Thank you.